Let me briefly, yesterday actually I forgot to tell you that what I started to do yesterday and will continue today is known under the name of the doi peliti formalism. This was what, and it was developed starting from 1976, which was an important year actually. Okay, and so, and also yesterday, I gave it for granted, but let me repeat. So the idea was, we have our master equation, and we would like to represent it as a sort of bona fide Hamiltonian in second quantization. So what we did, we introduced the Fock space. I said we introduced the vacuum, which corresponds to the absence of particle in our system. And then, out of the vacuum, we create the state with one particle via the action of the creation operator, the state with two particles, and so on, okay? And then we keep on going, and then we go down with the destruction operator. And we said that it has a certain, we fix the normalization in a convenient way also from the mnemonic point of view. What I gave for granted, which was in a sense implicit in the notation, is that correspondingly correspondingly you have a bra space, okay? And the bra space is basically just saying that we have the bra vacuum, and then you create the bra one particle state with the action to the right with a dagger, with a, and so on and so forth, okay? Like they would be one the conjugate of the other, okay? And then what I forgot to mention is that in all the calculation, you assume that the vacuum is normalized, okay? And then I was asking you to, knowing all that, you should be able to calculate the normalization and n prime, which, as I said, is not a delta, okay? It was the notes, two things to tell you, okay? So, but then eventually we said what we ended up with was something like an Hamiltonian in second quantization. For example, yesterday we derived explicitly that we can write formally the equation of motion for our representative state in the form minus h phi of t. And as an example, we worked out partially together the fact that the Hamiltonian h is in general a reaction part plus a diffusion part, when this reaction part, for the case of simple annihilation that we saw yesterday together, lambda a, this object here takes the form of lambda a dagger minus 1 a dagger a square, while the diffusion part, which has to do indeed with diffusion in space, we said takes the form of minus d, what is that? Actually, plus d. A dagger j minus a dagger I, a j minus a I, where this is in general is summed over all sides between which you can have jumps. Okay, and then we said that as an important property, fundamental properties of all these Hamiltonian because of the conservation probability, is that when we replace, once they are written in normal order, which is important, once you replace a dagger with the number one, the Hamiltonian has to vanish. Otherwise, probability is not conserved. And this is true for this and this. Okay? So that's the point. So, but this is a, okay? And then, yes. And then remember, at a certain point, we said this is about the dynamics, and in order to calculate the expectation values, what we have to do, we have also to introduce a projection state. So we introduce the projection state, which is useful to calculate expectation value of observable. This projection state is characterized by the fact that it is the left eigenvector of the creation operator, okay? And actually, remember, it was defined by the condition that it says projection 1 over all possible n particle states, okay? It was the definition, and then it came out, this was a consequence of this definition. We will need things today. So today what I would like to do is, okay, now we have a formalism, which is a sort of second quantization. We would like to do a path integral representation. Why? Because typically to path integral, you know how to apply a certain number of approximation schemes and so on and so forth. These things that you learn when you do field theory, and especially statistical field theory. And that is a convenient way, especially in view of the fact that you might be interested in it means, as you know, it's more convenient also for generating, perturbation theory and so on and so forth. No? So the idea is, how do we do this field theoretical representation? So this is basically from second quantization. So this was second quantization to field theory to a path integral. This is what I'm going to do today. And then the point is, how do we do it? It is very convenient. The one that I'm going to show you today, I don't know whether I will have time to show you alternative ways, but it's one possible way of going from a second quantized theory to the field theory. If I have time at the end, I will also show you another one. So this goes under the name of coherent state path integral. Okay? Which is something, well known also when you do many body quantum mechanics. If you do many body theory starting from solid state, you find something like this. I have to review it briefly because given the normalization of this coherent states, they are different. There will be some differences. Okay. So you see the main player are here in this game now are coherent states. How are coherent states defined? The coherent states are defined as eigenstates of the distraction operator. Okay. So I will indicate them like bra phi, the ket phi, and the corresponding bra is going to be the eigenstate to the left of the creation operator. So in this sense, you see that the projection state is nothing but the coherent state with eigenvalue 1. Given that formally this A and A-dag, operator A is not Hermitian, we expect in general phi to be a complex number. There is no reason why it should be real, so it's a complex number. Now, from this definition, I give you a set of exercises, small exercises. So first of all, determine phi. Or if you want to show that, you can write phi. This is a really simple exercise. Define phi is given by the exponential of minus 1 alpha phi modulus square plus phi a dagger applied to the vacuum. Where you see, basically, is given by the action of the exponential phi a dagger on the vacuum, and the normalization has been fixed such that in principle, this leaves the normalization open. So you normalize them in such a way that this is equal to 1. Okay. So this is the first property. Basically, as a consequence of the definition, you can give the coherent state this explicit expression. What you can now prove is that if you do the integral in d phi star, so as I said, phi is complex, so if you do the integral over the whole complex plane, phi of phi star, of this object here, this is equal to the identity. The identity in the Fock space. What do I mean by that? Something like equal to the sum over n for 0 plus infinity of n, n. That's the identity in the focus space. Okay. So it looks like, as you know, also in quantum mechanics, it looks like they are good candidate to form a basis. But actually, the basis of our focus space. But actually, there are too many of them. So in the sense that they are not orthogonal to each other. And indeed, part C of the exercise is to calculate the normalization, the scalar product between these states. What you discover is that phi prime, is equal to the exponential of minus 1/2 phi modulus square minus 1/2 phi prime modulus square plus phi star phi prime. Okay? In order to prove this, you should use what I discussed yesterday, the properties of the shift operator in terms of A and A-dag. It's quite simple consequence of what I said yesterday. So this tells you that coherent states corresponding to different eigenvalues, they are not orthogonal, so there are too many of them, if you want. In principle, you could do a sort of orthogonalization procedure and get rid of some of them, but it is not convenient. It is convenient to keep all of them in principle, okay? And actually, another thing that you is going to be useful in a second is the following. That imagine you have a function which is normally ordered. So you have a function h of a dag and a which is normally ordered. Okay. If you have this function, and you calculate something like the matrix element of this H between these coherent states. This object here is equal to what? I mean, you can do explicitly the calculation taking into account the expression of phi like here, and using again the thing that I showed you yesterday about the shift operators. Another way of calculating this object is quite obvious, no? If it is normally ordered, A on phi prime is phi prime. A dag on phi is phi. So this object here simply becomes H of the function, then phi prime, and then you are left with phi prime, which is written there. Okay, and phi star, you are right. This is phi star. Okay, thank you. Because it's to the left. Okay, and this object here, then we can use this, and then let me write there explicitly because I will need it quite soon. So this object here then is h of phi star phi prime. But then I rewrite this normalization factor in a more convenient way for my needs. It is e to minus 1/2. I can always write it like phi star times phi minus phi prime plus 1/2 phi star minus phi prime star phi prime. You see here you have phi star, phi modulus square, phi prime, phi star prime with the minus phi prime modulus square, and then this phi star phi prime, you have it twice. Okay? And so you reconstruct this. Okay? It is just more convenient. Okay? Now, why is this... are these properties useful? Because now remember that the formal solution of this equation, we know it. We can certainly write the formal solution in this form. So we know that, and remember, once we know phi of t, we know everything about our theory, because once we take the scalar product with the n particle states, we will recover our Pn of t. So the is actually Pn of t. So our stochastic problems, if we know this, is completely solved. And so we know that this object is e to minus h. Actually, let me call this now capital T. Minus ht phi of zero. And so what we would like to do is to represent this element in a path integral, so time evolution operator in a path integral. And how do we do it? In the quite standard way, you take, as you do when you go from quantum mechanics to Feynman, standard quantum mechanics to the operatorial quantum mechanics to the Feynman path integral, like you take the evolution operator and you do the Trotter decomposition, okay? So this means that, now let me see what I need. I don't need much of this. So what we do something like this. Now I need the space. Okay, so in principle, we simply write e to minus, like, okay, so let me go here, e to minus ht, we represent it formally like the limit for delta t going to zero, of, if you want, 1 minus delta t times h to the power t over delta t. Or if you want, you pile up t minus delta t elements, okay? So this means that, there is always a geometrical issue here. Yes. In a sense, what you do, you represent, imagine now I do a sort of time axis. So, and then I take this e to minus ht, I represent it like a series of factors, 1 minus delta th, 1 minus delta th, and so on and so forth, 1 minus delta th, okay? And this is done t plus delta t time. And each of these factors is making my time advancing by an interval delta t. So here I have time 0, here I have time delta t, 2 delta t, and so on and so forth. Here I will get time t minus t capital T, here time t minus delta t, and so on and so forth. Okay? Where this axis above is just a picture. Okay? So, and eventually I have e to minus ht obtained as a limit for delta t going to zero of this object. Okay? Now the idea is the standard one. So what we are going to do, we are going to insert the identity in the form of the resolution of the identity via the coherent states, and we do it in each single time slice, okay? And therefore for convenience I will introduce the identity here in the form as the integral in d phi star d phi over pi phi. But then, given that I have to do it everywhere, I need an index. So, and I will use as an index here, delta t, delta t, delta t, delta t. Just an index. And then I repeat it everywhere. So, when I insert it generically, I will generically insert something like the integral in d phi star, in d phi t star d phi t, over pi phi t generically, okay, where t delta t and so on and so forth. So eventually you see, if I take a generic matrix element, it will be always it will have on the right phi t, on its left phi t plus delta t. So once I know what is a matrix element, what I need to know is simply the matrix element phi t plus delta t, 1 minus delta t h phi t. If I know this matrix element, I can basically represent this object as a train of integrals with these matrix elements. Okay? You agree? But what is this matrix element? Assuming that h is in normal order, I will repeat it till I die, H in normal order. If it, again, if when you map the your master equation, maybe you don't end up in a Hamiltonian in normal order. You know, you make it normal order by using the commutation relations, and then you use that functional form. Okay. So this object is quite simple, because then this object here, we fall in this category. It's written here. So it's simply what is written here, where H now is evaluated on this object. And then remember that what matters here are the linear terms in delta t. So this 1 minus delta t H, so let me do this step by step. So this object here is basically 1 minus delta t times h, so our h is h of a dagger a, being in normal order. So then this h takes the value phi t plus delta t, here phi star t plus delta t phi t, gets out of the expectation value. And then I have this scalar product between these two coherent states, which is what is written there. Okay, so then I have the exponential e to minus 1 half phi star t plus delta t. Phi t plus delta t minus phi t, and then plus one half phi star t plus delta t minus phi star of t times phi t. Okay? Do you agree? Now, this expression, in the throttle decomposition, if I modify this expansion by terms of order delta t squared, the result is the same, because it's valid up to order delta t. So what I can do, I can take this object and send it to the exponential. Okay? So this object then is equal to up to order is equal to the exponential, everything now is at the exponential of of this object here, minus 1 half phi star t plus delta t phi t plus delta t minus phi of t plus 1 half phi star t plus delta t minus phi star t phi t minus delta t times h of phi star t plus delta t phi t plus order delta t square. Okay. Wait. Just a second. Step by step. Now the issue is that now what I can do, I mean, as he was suggesting, now let's look at what we have. Imagine now remember that this t was just an index, a discrete index for my labeling of coherent state. You see, if I promote my coherent state to become a function of this time, so I promote the index as a variable, I can take the limit delta t going to zero, and so what do I get from here? See, clearly that from here I get a time derivative. So this will eventually give you the time derivative, and this is also will give you the time derivative. Okay, while here I can up to this order I can replace it with the function at the time t. So for delta t going to zero, let me see where I go now. I go here. I beat the gravity. So we go here. This object here is equal to the exponential of minus 1/2, then this becomes phi star t. Here I get dt phi t plus 1/2 dt phi star t phi t minus delta t h of phi star t phi t plus order delta t square. Okay? And now you see, eventually I have to sum over all possible intermediate steps. But the sum of the possible intermediate steps now becomes, given that, sorry, nobody pointed out that I forgot a delta t here. So it's delta t here plus delta t. Oh, it's all of order delta t. I mean, when I take the whole product of the intermediate steps time the delta t, what I'm constructing formally is the Riemann sum. You agree? So what happens then when I take the continuous limit of this, I will have at the extreme I have the coherent state 0, 0 and tt. And then what is in between becomes a path integral with the exponential, which is the integral in time of this object. Okay? Is that clear? So for this reason, let me go here. So eventually, let me see this. Eventually, this. What I can say is that e to minus ht is equal to, again, let me write it, the limit for delta t going to zero of, then we have the product in t of the integral in d phi star t d phi t over pi. This product is in all possible slices. And then we have the phi t here. And then we have, in general, phi 0. And then, so this is these are the only projector which are left. And then all this is multiplied by, actually, let me write it like this. All that is multiplied by this phi 0 e to minus ht, sorry, phi t, e to minus ht phi 0. And for this object here, we can represent this as exponential of now let me see the notation. I never remember if I put the minus. I don't put the minus. The exponential of minus the integral between 0 and t and capital T in dt of what is written there. Which is 1/2 phi star t dt phi t minus 1/2 phi dt phi star t phi t minus a plus h phi star t phi t. Is that clear? You see that basically we have our path integral. Now, let me delete this. Then I don't need this. So you see that the the bulk of the matrix element takes the form of a function, an integral over an exponential of a function. Okay. Now let's give a look at now you see that if you forget for a while about boundary terms, which are important, but imagine you are interested in what happens at infinite time, in the stationary state of your process, so you can extend it to plus infinity. So you see that these two derivatives are the same. If you integrate this by parts, for example, you get, or actually, which one I prefer? Yes, if you integrate this by parts, this object here is up to boundary term simply phi star t dt phi t. Okay? Basically, you see that the path integral associated to our the path integral associated to our evolution, or if you want, the propagator of our theory, is going to be of the form phi star phi t dt phi t plus the Hamiltonian. Okay, so and. Remember, the Hamiltonian is the one that we got from the master equation after normal ordering. As you can see, is a field theory which involves two fields, phi star and phi. We will see later, and you have to integrate in principle over phi star and phi independently. Remember, the original integral was on it's the integral in the phi star phi t. It was on the whole complex plane, but you can change basis and do the integral on phi star and phi as independent variables, okay? But before going on, later on we will discuss the structure of this theory, because it is quite actually peculiar. You will see that it's a field theory with a very funny, with a very strange propagator, okay? But before going that, remember that eventually what we would like to cast in a field theoretical form are actually expectation values of observables. Remember that we have this projection state to deal with. So what we would like to find, we would like to find a field theoretical representation for things like the expectation of an observable or a time t. So remember that what is this expectation value of observable or time t? So the observable, okay. So we said that it is, in order to calculate this, we have to take the projection state, then the observable O, which in general is going to be, the observable O is going to be a function of the occupation number of particles, typically. So it's going to be a function of A dag A. But in this formula, we can also accommodate observables, which are separate function of A dag and A. The important thing is that it's normally ordered. Okay, so let me assume that this is of the form A dag A, normally ordered. And then we have to put the state at time t, which is E to minus H t phi of 0. Okay, now for this object here, we have already this the representation above. So here we will introduce like phi 0. Here we introduce phi t, and the corresponding integration over it. So this matrix element here is already known, which is basically there. So what we have to discuss are the remaining two matrix elements, which are the matrix element, let me go here. So what we have eventually is P O A dag A phi t. Phi t, and then we have phi 0. Okay? But this is also simple, because if it is normally ordered, A on phi t gives you phi t. Okay? So and A dagger on P, we said that P is the left eigenstate of A dagger to the eigenvalue 1, gives you 1. So this object here becomes O of 1 phi t, and then we are left with the normalization between P and phi t. But P is also basically a coherent state with eigenvalue 1. Remember from the definition. And so it's basically the matrix element between the state with eigenvalue 1 and phi t. And this is the normalization of the coherent state that I ask you to calculate. And so eventually this object here is simply O of 1 phi t e to minus phi t plus 1 half phi t modulo square, or minus, now it's it's the opposite, plus phi t minus, and the check with the normalization of the coherent states that I ask you to calculate. Okay, and then there is the last element, which is phi 0 phi of 0, capital phi of 0. What is capital phi of 0? Remember, is the superposition. So this is object is the sum for n going from 0 to plus infinity of phi of 0 n pn at time 0. So the initial probability of the evolution of our system. Okay. Again, this thing can be easily calculated. I ask you to do it as an exercise, and then the result is, I have it here. No, where is that? Okay. It's, once you know the definition of the coherent state, this is a simple exercise. This object here becomes phi 0 star to the power n e to minus 1 half phi 0 modulo square. So you see that then this object is e to minus 1 half phi 0 modulo square sum over n from going from 0 to plus infinity of pn of 0 phi 0 star to the power n. So the object which is here is nothing but the generating function of the initial probability calculated on phi 0 star. Okay? And it is convenient to write it because, you know, eventually we would like to send all our factors to the exponential. We will write it like e to minus a0 of phi 0 star, which is a sort of cumulant generating function of the initial probability. So this has to do with the initial probability. Okay? When we put everything together in the proper form, now let me see if I'm able to do it without mistake. Let's put everything together. So, okay. So this whole matrix element, it takes the form of a path integral on, now I will use the curly derivative to mean that I forget about the normalization and they would already take the continuum limit. We'll have then d phi star of all the factors that I piled up so far. So we have the observable O calculated in 1 phi t, and then then the rest is in the exponential, times the exponential of what? We have phi t minus 1 half phi t modulo square from here. Then we have minus 1 half phi 0 modulo square from here, minus a 0 of phi 0 star from here. Okay? And then we have the big part of the evolution, which is the one extensive in time, if you want, which is minus the integral between 0 and capital T in dt of 1 half phi star dt phi t Okay. Phi star t dt phi t minus 1 half dt phi star t phi t plus h phi t star phi t. Okay. You see, compared to most of the field theories you have seen so far, this one has a peculiar feature. The time is bounded, so you have boundaries. Indeed, when you look at it, you can easily recognize what I would call, then we will see that it's a bit dangerous to do this kind of distinction, but there is a bulk term, bulk term in the sense that it depends on the large part of the time, so part which is extensive in time, which is given by this, and then a boundary term, which has to do with that. Actually, this is an interesting stuff, because it shows you that indeed, up to the issue of causality, these theories, they have a relationship with field theories in the presence of boundaries. If you want to study the non-equilibrium behavior of these systems, you will find a certain number of relationship, at least morally, with the theory. For example, if you want to study the also in equilibrium, if you want to study the easy model in the presence of a boundary. The boundary in the sense that it breaks a fundamental symmetry of the bulk, which is translational invariance. Here, in principle, the fact that the action has an initial contribution breaks time translational invariant. Of course, if you are interested in the steady state, you can say, okay, at very long time, what happens at the very early times does not really matter, so I can forget about the boundaries. Okay? But otherwise, if you want to study relaxation phenomena, for example, you have to care about the boundaries in this theory. Okay? Is that clear? Now, let me do another second of to rewrite it properly. Yes. Yes, you have to integrate over everything at this point. It's written here. Now, I mean, you see here you have to integrate over everything. I mean, this has to be a number. Should not depend on anything. The propagator, still you have to fix the boundaries, but when you calculate the matrix element, there are really interesting things like this. Okay? But it's also here and here, and actually is hidden here. Now let's do it properly. So when you do the, so as I said, here is convenient to do an integration by parts. Okay? So when you do the integration by parts, you generate a boundary term that you have to account for it. Okay? So from here you get that this object here, you can write it like dt phi t star phi t minus phi t plus no mi- okay, minus phi t star dt phi t. And so you see that this part with this minus and sums up with that, and then you are left with evaluating the boundary terms there. Okay, so eventually, out of the, when you rewrite, okay, no, I have to rewrite it. So let me go here. I rewrite only the exponential; the rest is the same. You eventually get the exponential of phi t minus 1/2. Phi t modulo square minus 1 half phi 0 modulo square minus a 0 phi 0 star, and now from here you get minus here you get phi t modulo square plus phi 0 modulo square. Okay? And then we are minus the integral between 0 and t in dt of phi star t dt phi t plus h phi star t phi t. Okay? And then clearly I forgot one half, okay? Because, no, I forgot several things. No, I forgot plus one half, no? Because this was minus, God, I did a mess, as usual. Minus, minus, plus one half, so this is plus one half. Okay? I think more or less we have there. Every time, you know. So you see, this cancel with this. And then that's it. I mean, this is the expression that you have, okay? For, see, and there is a part which depends on the final time. But again, depending, you know, it depends on how you turn this by parts, you can always generate a boundary term. Either at plus infinity or t. But the important thing is that you have to realize that it takes the form of a, now forget about this phi t, it takes the form of a boundary action, which is localized at phi zero, and a bulk term, which takes this form, okay? Now, I did it in the case, and then, well, you can specialize these, you can specialize this construction to let's say a zero, which is the moment generating function. I mean, depending on the your initial condition, this will take a certain form and so on and so forth. Yes. Imagine you, I mean, if you want to calculate, so, okay, so here it's a stochastic dynamics. So imagine your observable is the number of particles. N is A daga A. Fluctuations, N square. No, I mean, at this moment it's highly unclear why you should consider something which is not just a function of the number of particles. Remember, in the stochastic model, what is important is the number of particles. We will see at a certain stage that actually sometimes you might want to consider also different things, but this will come later. Yeah, you do some algebra. You do n square, you write, so you have, if you want n square, you write it as a daga a square, which is not in normal order. So you first put it in normal order by using properly the commutation relations, and then you apply this formula here. And indeed, you will see that this was something that I also mentioned yesterday. I mean, while if you do, you will see that if you want to calculate the average of n, then you get a daga a, which is already in normal order. So eventually, this object here will be phi t, what you write here. And then you say, okay, so my average of number of particles eventually transforms in a field theoretical average of phi t with this action. But now if you do this, you discover that this maps into phi t square plus phi t. So even if n is the average of phi t, the fluctuation of n are not just these, but there is also this term. Okay, one has to be careful with that. Okay, do it, check it. Okay. Now, clearly, okay, so here, what I did here was the calculation of an observable at a certain time t. But as usual, as you know, when you do path integral, when you go from the operator point, from the operatorial expression to the path integral expression, you have to keep into account time ordering, okay? So, for example, if you are interested in calculating the number of particle I at time t, actually at time t prime, times the number of particle at site j at time t, when you do this decomposition of the evolution operator, you have to keep into account time ordering. So do it as an exercise. It's the usual stuff that you do in quantum field theory, okay? Actually, here I was assuming that I have only one lattice site. If you have many lattice sites, it's simply you have to do this construction for each lattice site. And so eventually what happens here, this will be summed over all single lattice sites, okay? As usual. So all these I leave it for you as a generalization. And then if as I said, if you are interested in the stationary properties of your stochastic model, you can typically neglect this boundary term and you can focus on the properties of this. So if you want stationary averages, they will eventually take form of a more or less standard field theory in which you have this as a field theoretical action. Okay. Now, imagine you know that in the stationary state of your problem you have the emergence of collective behaviors, as I showed you in the first lecture. You might have things which resemble a lot second order phase transitions. Then it is really tempting to check whether this second order phase transition, like, they correspond to renormalization group fixed points of the action of your field theory. And this is exactly what we are going to do next. So should I stop now? Question? Yes. Yes. We if you wait 10 minutes of the break, we will discover this. Okay? Okay. So, oh, okay, I did it. Okay, so this was in general. So the question is, what do we get eventually? Okay, so let's give a look at the structure of some the resulting field theory that we have eventually to study in order to understand the possible emergence of collective properties. So if you, for example, no, but this is not the example I want to make. Just a sorry. So just to look at the issue in the full. So imagine now we have a thing which is part. I'm asking you to study in the exercise sheet of yesterday. Today there will be another one, so hurry up. And so if, for example, if you take a process which has this binary annihilation, which goes in zero, so it annihilates in pairs. And it has also diffusion. So this means that we have to add also space degrees of freedom. So we have more than one side. So if you take this process, you discover that the Hamiltonian, we said, is the diffusion Hamiltonian plus the reaction Hamiltonian. And it turns out that the diffusion Hamiltonian is the one that I wrote before. So it's the sum over I and j of d times a dagger I minus a dagger j times ai minus aj when we are on the lattice. And while the reaction Hamiltonian, this is exercise for you, is minus lambda sum over I of one minus a dagger I, sorry, a dagger square a square I. Okay. Again, usual properties: if a dagger I substitute with one, it's zero. Fundamental issue. Then you see immediately that. So what we have to do? So these are HD in terms of a dagger and I, no? And this is HR in terms of a dagger and I. Okay. Now what we have to do in order to find the corresponding path integral. Or if you want, now I'm going to write only the bulk part of the action. So out of here, we get something which is the bulk part of the action, which depends on the field phi and phi star. This is equal to what we have. We said is the integral between 0 and t. In dt, there is going to be the sum over lattice sides of what? You see, actually, let's imagine, so we have to calculate this object in phi, we have to put phi star here and phi here. And then we have eventually, imagine we take the continuous limit. If we take the continuous limit, this object, these two objects becomes what? What? Gradient, no? The continuous limit, this becomes a gradient of the fields. They become both gradients of the fields. Okay. So what happens eventually? So we will have eventually the integral over space. Imagine we are in the dimension of what we will have. The part which comes from the normalization of covariance states, which is then phi star t dt phi t plus h. Okay. So then this object here then becomes plus d times, let's say, the lattice spacing a square. No, sorry. There are, okay. L square. So with L is the lattice spacing, because this is going to become sort of lattice spacing. The L square, and then we get the gradient phi gradient phi t gradient phi t star. So the diffusion terms takes this form, and then we have minus lambda 1 minus phi star square phi square. Okay. The one before the one which we discussed the last time was a plus a, which goes in a. Here is binary annihilation. So now, if we look at this theory, so we see what? Okay, first of all, okay, so in order to cast it, you know, what we can do, this has to do with interaction. So we focus only on this part here, which is diffusion. You see that eventually you can write this object at phi star t, dt minus d Laplace, let me call this combination d bar Laplacian square phi t. See that the propagator of our theory is strange, because it mixes phi star and phi. So what you can do, and actually one could be tempted in doing you know, change of variable and so on and so forth, but it is convenient to think of this object as a sort of a matrix. You imagine that they form a sort of doublet, phi star, phi t. You have a matrix which is zero, something here, zero, phi star, t, phi t, where this something is one half of this. Okay, so you see you have this strange non-diagonal propagator, which we will have to deal in a second. Another thing to remember. Remember that this whole object that I forgot to tell you at the very beginning, so sorry for that. This is so this is phi t, phi t. So this is phi t star, phi t. What do we know about this Hamiltonian? Fundamental rule. That if I put phi star equal to 1, it vanishes. For this reason, it is convenient always to shift, and this shift is called DOI shift, to redefine a new variable, which I call phi tilde, such that phi star t is equal to 1 plus phi tilde t. So you shift it compared to 1. Nothing spectacular, but it is useful, okay? And actually then, when you do the functional integral, I mean, the change of variable here is measure 1. So when you do the functional integral, then you will eventually do the functional integral over d phi and d phi tilde. This phi tilde, we will see later that it has an important physical interpretation as a sort of response field. We will see. At this moment it's unclear, but it has a physical interpretation, okay? Okay, but given that Andrea was asking for the rabbits, now given that we know that, as I showed you, we have this phase transition. Remember I showed you the first lecture, the presence of this phase transition in this simplifying model. So let's then focus on this and try to see how we can work out the renormalization group for that model, okay? So let's go back to the process, branching and decay process with little competition, and see what is the field theoretical action. So you will see it has this shape, this form. We will do it properly, okay? So we go back to our reaction of branching. So we have the model which undergoes reproduction with rate sigma, remember our rabbit. It undergoes decay, A, which goes with the rate mu to zero. And then we know the phase diagram of this object. And then we add the little competition, which we have A plus A, which with rate lambda goes in A. Okay? And then we said that this we proved, you should have proven it explicitly, that if we forget about this reaction and we look at this object, there is the phase diagram of this object. You know, we could calculate, here we had mu over sigma. We could, so this was the asymptotic survival of the model with lambda equal to zero. We discovered that it has a sort of phase transition which looks like a ferromagnet, and we said that the dynamical critical exponent is new. We said that the beta exponent, and so on and so forth. Okay. Then, when you add this, in principle, things change slightly, because I mean, without interaction, we could get the phase transition even in zero dimension. When you add interaction, actually you discover that the phase transition in zero dimension is destabilized, and so it does not occur in zero dimension, but it actually occurs in one dimension, which is still surprising if you take into account the Peier's argument or maybe magnetic theory, but we are out of equilibrium and so on and so forth. Now the question is, I mean, with our theoretical machinery that we have set now, can we calculate, for example, first of all, can we see the emergence of a renormalization group fixed point, which has to do with the presence of a phase transition, this scale invariance in your system? And then how can we characterize it? Okay, so in principle, with what I told you so far, we should be able to do so. Okay, so now, out of this model exercise for you to derive the reaction and diffusion, diffusion Hamiltonian is always the same. Exercise for you is to derive the reaction Hamiltonian. So it turns out that the reaction Hamiltonian for this system, written in normal order, is equal to 1 minus A dagger, when we do the second quantization, sigma A dagger A minus mu A minus lambda A dagger A square. And therefore, our action, now if we do the translation that we said, our action, it becomes something like phi star, which is equal, I do not yet introduce phi tilde, but we will see that it's quite natural in a while. So it's going to be the integral in dt, the dx in general, and the dimensions of phi star dt minus d Laplacian square phi. Now I don't indicate the suffix t. I imagine that the field phi is a function of x and t, plus 1 minus phi star, which multiplies, then I copy here by substitution, sigma phi star phi minus mu phi star, minus mu phi phi minus lambda phi star phi square. Okay? Now, when you see a field theory action like this, what do you do first? You have a field theory, no? We agree on that. We have two fields even, you know. What do you do with this? No, the CISA should stay silent. What do you do? Mean field. Okay. So saddle point. Let's see. Whatever we do, we hope that is dominated. Inside regime is also true physically, but it's hopefully dominated by the saddle point of this equation. So let's look at what we get as a saddle point. So the saddle point equation, we have to impose that. We have to impose that the functional derivative of the action with respect to phi on the saddle point is equal to zero, and the functional derivative with respect to t, of a with respect to phi star is equal to zero. We have to do this, okay? And this determines the saddle point equation. As simple as that. Now let's do it. So let's take first the derivative with respect to phi star. So when you take the functional derivative, you are left with this object here. So this implies that you have dt minus d Laplacian square phi. This phi is understood as being the saddle point. I should put a bar, but otherwise, if I start putting bars, I get confused soon. And then I have to take the functional derivative of this. The functional derivative of this comprises two terms. The first term is the functional derivative of this with respect to phi, which gives us a minus. And then I can write this object here, minus sigma phi star phi minus mu phi minus lambda phi star phi square. Okay? And then I have the derivative of this object times 1 minus sigma, plus 1 minus phi star times the derivative, which is sigma phi minus lambda phi square, is equal to 0. have a doubt now. I don't know, it's fine. Okay? So let's take the derivative of the other. Now, before doing the derivative of the other, it's always convenient to turn the integration by parts, because I have to do the derivative with respect to phi. It's always, as usual, to each other. In principle, this will generate boundary terms, but as we are interested in what happens in the stationary state, for now on, we will only consider the bulk action, so neglecting the boundary terms. We're interested in the stationary properties at long times. So then, when we do this derivative, we get that this derivative takes a minus, the Laplacian takes two minuses that it takes a plus, minus d Laplacian square phi star, it was the variation of this, and then we have to the variation of this with respect to phi, plus 1 minus phi star, and then we have sigma phi star minus mu, minus 2 lambda phi star phi. Okay? Is equal to zero on the saddle point equation. Agree with me? What is a solution of this system? So we have to find a solution of this system of differential equations. Do you see an easy solution? At least for the first one? One. It's not surprising. I told you the one is important. So this is clearly satisfied. Actually, it's always satisfied because remember the structure 1 minus phi star, which is, has to be there because conservation of probability. So phi star equal to 1 is always the solution of the saddle point equation. Okay? So phi star equal 1. Question, is it the only one? That's another issue. We will see, hopefully, next lecture that might not be always the only one. So phi star equal to 1 for sure is a solution. Now, let's check what happens then to the second equation if we put phi star equal to 1. So the second equation then becomes dt minus d Laplacian square phi is equal, I take on the other side. So this one disappears. And so I have this one only, okay? Is equal to sigma minus mu phi minus lambda phi square. Okay? What is this equation? This is the rate equation for our reaction. So you could have get this equation without knowing anything about field theory, but simply looking at what I wrote here. No? Let's check. So let me rewrite. So imagine we do it, exercise, separate exercise. I don't know where to do it here. Okay. So if you ask your grandmother, you say, okay, you know, I have this kind of reaction. What do you expect? Your grandmother will tell you, well, then, you know, this tells me how much my population changes as a function of time. So if I call n, let's say the average value of the number of individuals, I expect to have something like dtn. So the change in time is due to what? To diffusion. Diffusion is what? Well, it's going to be something like you should have a quite educated grandmother, but that's fine. The Laplacian square times n, which accounts for the fact that your population is spreading. And then what? Then you see that, again, here you gain one individual with rate sigma, and in a way which is proportional to your population, so you will gain plus sigma n. Here it kills with the same rate proportional to n, minus mu n, and this one instead kills two guys with a rate, kills one guy with a rate which is proportional to the number of pairs that I can do. So the number of pairs, it goes like n square, so then I will write minus lambda n square. if you compare the two lines. This is the reason why I was telling you that the rate equation is the mean field, is the mean field, is what you get out of mean field theory. In this sense here, if you do the full theory, which in principle is able to account for fluctuations, and you do mean field theory on that in order to find the stationary point of your action, you discover what you would get simply by reasoning, by hand waving. Okay? Because I'm cheating a bit, of course. because n you assume to be large. Now, if you want to, you can do it more detailed. Indeed, there is a small shift. But yes. Yeah, if I do this properly, it doesn't match. So this is what is sure. If you do this, I mean, if you take the saddle point, you are on the safe side. Okay. Indeed, if you do instead the midfield, like I was asking you in the exercise sheet, to do it at the level of master equation, you get also this factor n minus one. You get things. You can do it refined. This is a midfield equation which works when you have a large number of particles. Okay. Very good. So we know this. And now, you see, from here, again, I mean, what we can get from this equation, we get exactly what we were discussing in the first lecture. So if you look at the average value of particles, you will discover that phi of t, so if you do a plot, phi of t for t going to infinity, it becomes what? When you look at this equation, you discover that it goes to zero exponentially. So if you do it, goes like e to minus mu minus sigma t if mu is larger than sigma. So it goes to zero if mu is larger than sigma. It goes algebraically to zero if mu is equal to sigma, because if mu equals to sigma, this term is not there. And so it goes algebraically like 1 over lambda t for mu equals sigma, and instead it goes to the asymptotic value SS, phi s equal to sigma minus mu over lambda if mu is smaller than sigma. And then we rediscover also in this way the absorbing state, zero, the critical state, mu equals sigma with an algebraic power law, which is the good candidate for being promoted to our critical point, and the active phase characterized by this sigma, and also we recover the exponent beta equal to 1 if we look now at the stationary value of phi as the order parameter. Okay? Now the question is, another thing, so in this equation, in solving this, you can forget about, you do mean field, so you forget about space dependence, and you assume that you have an homogeneous solution. Of course, if you want to study the wave fronts that I showed you in the simulations, then I mean you have to take into account that object if you want to study the propagation wave front. But if you study in the behavior close to this point here, where you fluctuate around zero, then you are fine with it. Okay. Now the question is, mean field, very good. What about fluctuations? So what do we expect from the effect of fluctuation? We built all this machinery to study fluctuations. And actually it turns out that, as in the case of equilibrium, when you study, imagine if you study equilibrium statistical physics, you discover that your system has a sort of second order phase transitions. You know that when you account for fluctuations beyond mean field, these fluctuations are going to modify the phase diagram of your system, but it does so in a non-universal way, which unfortunately field theory is unable to capture. So never try to study a phase diagram field theory, because this depends on the microscopic details of the system. But then it will also affect, in a universal way, for example, the algebraic singularities. So the point is that it is going to change the location of this critical point, and is going to affect also the power which characterizes the relaxation. Okay? These are the two things. So now let's see how we can capture these issues. Okay. Okay. So before doing that, by the way, so there is another issue. I forget. Fluctuation. Are fluctuations always relevant? This answer should be like a choir. Should say, fluctuation always relevant? No, okay, very good. No, for example, if you are far from the critical point, you know, there is, you know, when you do equilibrium statistics of physics, there is this Ginzburg criterion telling you that you can neglect fluctuations. I mean, they do not change qualitatively the physics of your system. But also if you are close to a critical point, you know that not necessarily fluctuations are dramatically changing your picture. Or at least, no? And this occurs above the upper critical dimensionality. Okay? Actually, to be precise, non-Gaussian fluctuations are irrelevant above the upper critical dimensionality. So the question is there a notion of upper critical dimensionality in this kind of models? Well, the only way we can understand it is indeed by applying what we know about field theory to this field theory here. I mean, in statistical mechanics, you can still understand it, but here, you know, the point is, what do we get for the upper critical dimensionality? This upper critical dimensionality is going to be connected to the relevance or the dimensionality at which the leading non-linearity become relevant, as it happens, as you know, when you do randomization group theory in equilibrium, okay? So, we have two missions now, to understand the upper critical dimensionality, to understand how to treat this strange theory with two fields, and to do randomization group. Okay, so I'll speed up. So, in order to study this equation, actually it is convenient to do a shift compared to the stationary value. Okay, now you will see we are going to study the critical point approaching it from the trivial phase. The trivial phase is actually the absorbing phase. So, what we are going to do, we are going to shift, first of all, it is convenient to do a slight change of variables, as I said. Which is the following. This is just a change of name. We introduce a field, I parameterize the field phi, I write it like sigma over lambda under square root times phi, and phi star, I write it like 1, mean field, I want to do fluctuations about mean field, plus lambda over sigma under square root phi tilde, okay? The change a bit normally. This is like the Doyle shift plus a constant, yes.
So here, phi star is not the complex
conjugate of phi. Yeah, no, I mean, in principle, when you insert the completeness, you have to integrate on the whole complex plane. You can change coordinate system and integrate on phi and phi star as independent variables. So, yeah, so that's why now I'm considering them as completely independent variables, okay? And so now, if you introduce this notation, what you discover is that your field theoretical action at becomes something like the integral in dt in ddx of phi tilde dt minus d Laplacian square plus r phi minus u half. The half is just for combinatorial convenience, phi tilde minus phi, phi tilde phi, plus lambda phi tilde square, phi square. Okay? Where I have introduced r, which is mu minus sigma, which is the distance from the critical point, basically. Remember, mu minus sigma was the distance from the critical point, and the coupling constant u is equal to 2 square root of lambda sigma. Okay, and lambda is the usual lambda, okay? Now again, now that we have done expansion around mean field, we can indeed look at the propagators, things like this. Okay? So now you see, this is the propagator of our theory, because the only quadratic part, and these one are interactions. See there, this is a bit bizarre compared, maybe you are used to Yukawa theory, maybe you are used to Phi-4 theory, you see, here you have a quite strange kind of interaction, you have a cubic interaction, a quartic interaction, and so on and so forth. So, and then there is also another peculiarity compared to the field theory you might be used to, the scaling. See, typically, you know, most of the field theories you might, I mean, at least those are relativistic due to Lorentz invariants, you have dt squared, like Klein-Gordon that I will show, you have dt squared minus Laplacian. So, space and time, they scale in the same way, because we know that thanks to relativity, they are connected. Here, this is not the case. See, time and space, they scale differently, with a power 2 of difference. Why? Well, remember that we are studying problems which are based on diffusion. And diffusion, Brownian motion, tells you that you need a time of order x squared to cover a distance x. So diffusive propagation versus ballistic or light cone-like propagation. Okay? This is going to have serious consequences in what follows, because you have, let's say, okay. And okay, so let's try to see what. So the point is that, as I was trying also to motivate at the very beginning of the course, why I decided to focus on this, because eventually it will turn out that this field theory describes a large universality class, which was encompassing direct percolation, infection spreading, so a series of models which seemingly they are not related, but they will eventually be described by the fixed point that we will eventually find for this theory, okay? Now, this is the action. Actually, for issues of renormalization group, it is convenient for me to add a scale, time scale here, because as I said, time and space, they don't scale equally, so I add this time scale constant. Okay. Now the question is, what I would like to do is implement a renormalization group. How many of you know renormalization group? Alla Wilson? Very good. Okay, so then on that I'll be fast. If you want to implement a renormalization group, we have to do it in three steps. First of all, we have to recognize that this theory that is written here needs to be amended by a cutoff, which has to do with the lattice lattice regularization. So what we do first regularize the theory by adding a cutoff in space. Okay? Let me call lambda the cutoff. Then we do RG in the three usual steps. So we let me call collectively phi the collection of phi and phi tilde, just to make my life easy. So what you do, as usual, you know, you separate the field phi in the fast component and the slow component. So you write that your field phi in momentum space is equal to phi fast of k plus phi slow of k, where phi fast of k involves modes which are in a shell of thickness rho around the upper the cutoff, okay? So this field phi k lives here, and this phi slow lives in the remaining part. So you have k smaller than rho lambda. And so the idea, in order to build and then we assume that rho is zero, is between zero and one, but eventually we will take rho like, we will see how we will take it, okay? And then what you do then the integration. So that's the first thing. Take the fields and decompose it, and then you do the integrate out from your for your expectation values, integrate out phi fast in order to get an effective action for phi slow. Okay, as usual. Now it goes really like in equilibrium field theory. Now, when you do this, when you integrate out phi fast, you get an effective action on phi slow. But now the cutoff of your theory has a cutoff rho lambda. No? It's like you have modified your lattice spacing. And therefore, the idea is to do a transformation back in order to restore the cutoff. Lambda in such a way the transformation can be iterated. Okay? So you do then the third point, rescaling of coordinates and fields. So this means that you will introduce coordinate x prime, which is equal to rho x, and with this transformation you re-establish the cutoff. Generically, you will have also to rescale time, so you will say that your new time is equal to rho to the certain power that I call zt. And generally, you will have to modify all your fields phi. You will define phi like you will call your phi of x. Can you read here? Okay. Phi of x and t, you will write it like rho to, let's say, a power d plus eta divided 2 phi prime of x prime t prime. Okay. This is just a convenient parameterization. Actually, when you do equilibrium, when you do this in equilibrium, you typically write here d minus 2 plus eta divided 2. Let me use this one. And in principle, now phi and phi tilde, they can scale with different exponents. So this we will discuss in a second. Okay? So once you have done this rescaling, now the action has exactly the same cutoff, and then you can compare it with the original one. And then eventually what you do, you take your combination x prime, t prime, phi prime, and you call it back x, t, phi. Just you rename it, because then you are back to the original point. Clearly the couplings are going to be modified. Okay? And basically, the way the couplings are modifying when I implement this tree transformation is building the randomization group flow, the randomization group transformation that we would like to discuss. Okay? So the couplings change. This is the RG flow. So it's telling you how the coupling, so your low energy effective field theory change with the scale of your theory, okay? That's what we have to do. But before doing that, we have indeed to first do the analysis for the Gaussian part. So this is the whole program in full, the full-fledged program, but we have to do it for the Gaussian part. Why? The Gaussian part is easy to implement. Why? Because when we do this decomposition, this composition can be easily done. But then, given that the part is the theory is Gaussian, these two sets of fields, they don't talk each other. So the Gaussian part is simply the Gaussian part for the fast field plus the Gaussian part for the slow field. When you integrate the fast fields, you simply get a constant which you couldn't care less. And so after integrating out the fast field, the effective action for this fast field effective action for the slow fields is exactly the same Gaussian part as before. Okay, is that clear? Gaussian theory, if you integrate fast modes, is still Gaussian. Okay, so I can delete here. Let's see what we get for the flow. We have to identify first our Gaussian fixed point. This is the missing lecture. So Giudici takes notes. Okay. So once we have done the integration, the effective action, AT effective, for the slow, for the fast, for the slow fields, I do not indicate the subscript, because it's clear that they are the slow fields. It's going to be what? It's going to be the integral dt, the integral dx of rho, the cutoff now is actually is rho lambda of phi tilde tau dt minus d Laplacian square plus r phi. It's the same as before. Now we do the point 3, we do the rescaling. So if we implement point 3 of our normalization group transformation, then by rescaling time, here we will get lambda minus 1, because we reinstate the old cutoff, lambda. And then the time dt becomes dt prime rho to the minus z, okay? And the space becomes dd x prime rho to the minus d. Yes. No, say it again. Yes. Yes. No, I mean, this is just to remember that it's just a notation. This, when I put lambda here, is simply to tell you that you have, if you want, lambda minus one, lattice spacing. Do you like it? Okay. Lambda minus one. It was just not to keep track of this minus one, okay? It was just a symbolic notation to say that, okay? So we have changed the measure, we have introduced these variables here, so we get x is rho to minus ds prime, blah, 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 so I write the measure, and then you see we have the factor for the fields. We have two fields, so we will get eventually rho to the d plus eta divided 2 times 2 for the two fields. And then what we get inside is we have then phi tilde prime, which multiplies then tau rho to the z dt prime, because now I'm introducing, because tau dt becomes rho to the z dt prime, minus d rho square Laplacian prime square plus r phi prime. Is that clear? As I said, in principle, I should let me finish and then I'll comment on it. Okay. Here, let me finish and then. So then you see that if this rho to the minus d is canceling these two half, so eventually you can rewrite this object in this form. I write it like lambda 2 minus 1 dt. Now I change names. I do this change in the names. I can kill the prime. So then this is dt dx of now you see this rho to the minus z, out of here I get rho to the power eta, because this d half times 2 is cancelled by this d half. I send this rho to minus eta inside, so then I get phi tilde tau dt minus minus d times rho to the 2 minus z Laplacian square plus r rho to the minus z times phi. Okay? You agree? Now you see that the final result of this game is that now if I compare the action with the new one, so the new action with the old one, it is like I have the same in which the coupling tau has become a coupling tau prime, which is rho to the eta times tau, rho to the eta times tau. Let me write it here, okay? So it's the same as having tau prime, which is equal to rho to the eta tau, d prime, which is equal to rho to the 2 minus z, z minus plus eta, 2 minus z plus eta d, and then r prime, which is equal to r times rho to the eta minus z. Rho to the eta minus z, r, okay? So the effect of doing this integration, which was highly trivial, is simply we have the same action as before, but with this new coupling constant, okay? Now, if we want our theory to be at a fixed point, so we are looking for the Gaussian fixed point, what should we ask? Oh, fixed point, we should ask that the derivative. What do you think simply? Imagine you ask this to your grandmother will tell you, these new couplings, they have to be equal to the old ones. I mean, fixed point means that I've done an iteration without doing anything. And so in order for this to be true, we have only basically one possibility. Eta is equal to 0. Z is equal to 2. And r equal to 0. Not surprisingly, we discover that the only fixed point in our theory is the critical point. Because if we are off the critical point, remember that this r is mu minus sigma, you are bound either to flow to minus infinity or to flow to plus infinity. Remember, because then when you reiterate the procedure, you will get another factor, basically rho to the minus 2. So you reiterate rho to the minus 2, rho is smaller than 1, so this r tends to grow. If it is positive, it grows to plus infinity, high temperature fixed point. If you go to minus infinity, low temperature fixed point, okay? So this tells us about Gaussian theory, which is completely determined this way, okay? I don't have time, right? Okay, so what we are going to do tomorrow, we continue on that. Now we have full control of the Gaussian theory. The first thing we have to understand is if all these couplings, they are all equally real. Before concluding, sorry, don't flee away. Now you see there is a point. In principle here we have two fields. What you do is, for example, Phi-4 theory, you have only one field, typically. And then, or even if you do Klein-Gordon, complex Klein-Gordon, you have Phi and Phi star, but it's just one field. Here we have two fields. So in principle, in this scaling here, I could have two different dimensions for eta, for the field phi and the field phi tilde. And actually, when you study this kind of dynamical phenomena, stochastic processes, you have always to allow for the anomalous, for the dimension of the field phi and the field phi tilde to be different. In that case, here, you would get instead of eta, this eta here, would become eta plus eta tilde, where eta tilde is the corresponding eta divided 2. And so you see that at a certain point you are in the embarrassing situation in which you have two unknown variables. You see here, in principle, from this reasoning, you cannot fix separately eta and eta tilde. I took them equal in view of this interaction. See, at the Gaussian level you don't know, you could do different choices, but here this interaction is telling you that the bare Lagrangian, the Lagrangian at the scale lambda, the action at the scale lambda, tells you that phi and phi tilde, they sort of play in a league. And so if I choose a different dimensionality for, choose for phi and phi tilde two different dimensions, one at a certain point will prevail on the other, which I don't want to do. Okay? It's your choice. I mean, at this level you can say, well, I don't care. If you don't fine tune this, you will get something different. Okay? But in general, when you do these models, the dimensionality of phi and phi tilde might be different. So this is something new compared to what you have when you do quantum field theory in a standard way. Okay? Okay, then tomorrow we understand if we can simplify this.